like this, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith.
Faith to faith.
As it is written,
yes, sir.
The just
shall
live by faith.
Amen.
The just
shall
live by faith. Let me say it one more time for emphasis. The just
shall
live by faith. I want to pause this morning, and I've been teaching, preaching on the subject of faithfulness to go the distance. And I want to use this morning for these three points, three simple points. Faith to go the distance. Faith to go the distance. Everybody has a lane, Amber, that God has assigned them to. For some people, that lane is a financial lane, spiritual lane. And when it comes on to a personal lane, people, results-oriented lane, everybody's got a lane that you operate in. And you're not your best when you're outside of that lane. And so you can't afford for anybody to distract you while driving in your lane.
All right,
amen.
All right,
preach, Pastor.
Secondly, everybody's lane has an express speed limit to get from one point to another. Some lanes are slower, some lanes are faster. Some lanes are less congested than others. But regardless of what, that's your lane.
Yes, sir.
And being comfortable in the lane that God has put you in is critical to your success.
Yes, it is.
When it comes on to spiritual things, I have a lane. My lane is a faith lane.
Yes, sir.
In other words, I'm always going to see faith in everything I do in that lane. Secondly, when I hit the faith lane, I believe when I'm in that lane that nothing is impossible.
All right, all right.
Amen. I'll see you soon.
Amen.
I believe that nothing is impossible. Do me a favor, look at your neighbor and say, nothing is impossible if God's in it. When you're in that faith lane, you start to say, like Peter, when he saw the storms upon the waters and upon the rivers, he started to say, Jesus, I see the storm, I see folks are trembling, but right now I'm in my faith lane. If you bid me to come, I'm going to step out of the security of this boat.
Yes, sir.
And I'm going to step out on faith in my lane, and I'm going to do what I've never done before, and that's to walk on water.
Yes, sir.
You know, when you're in your faith lane, you can almost walk on water.
Yes, sir.
And when you're in your faith lane, stuff you touch, they say you got the minus touch. No, you just operate in your faith lane, and the stuff you touch seems to start to turn to gold.
Yes, sir.
I wonder, do I have a witness in here?
Hallelujah.
When you're in your faith lane, stuff that used to have you panicking cause you to start praising. That's why you may be in the same situation you've been. When you're in your faith lane, all of a sudden, you're optimistic instead of pessimistic.
Yes, sir.
I wish I had a church in here this morning. When you're in your faith lane, praise God, nobody can take you off your square. I know that's an old school term now, but nobody can pull you out of your faith lane and disturb your peace, because you realize that if I stay right here, God's going to come see about me. I wish I had a church in here. So faith, amen, praise God, amen, allows you to do the impossible thing with the same set of circumstances that you had before. In other words, you may not get any more resources, but faith begins to work behind the scenes of what you already have. Come on, Moses, what's in your hand? I know the river, the water seen is before you, but what's in your hand? I got my 10 minutes and I'm done. Amen. Praise God. So when you're in your faith lane, don't let anybody stop you. Especially those who don't have your faith. Ah, Lord, have mercy. Those who don't have your faith will say, Peter, don't get out of the boat. You're sure to sink. Oh, Lord, no. But when you're in your faith moment, you can look at things that you used to doubt before and say, I'm going to make it through. I wish I had the church. Oh, somebody operating in the faith lane this morning. And you got the faith to go the distance.
Hallelujah.
the writer declares, amen, the just shall live by faith. Come here, if you're preaching your neighbor, tell them the just shall live by faith. What does that mean? The word just is a short form of the word justified. Ah, Lord, have mercy. It means, amen, those who believe that you have been justified means that God has forgiven my sins, not based on my works, but based on the fact that my faith in the finished work of Calvary has made me justified as if I have not sinned in his presence. So because I'm now standing in his presence, now with no sins, the Lord have mercy, standing in his presence with no condemnation, Lord have mercy, standing in his presence with not having to look over my back, amen, praise God. That justified person shall live by faith. Oh God, help me, Holy Ghost. This is, I believe that I'm justified. I believe I'm on my way to heaven, amen, praise God. I believe that God's going to prepare a place for me. It means that when I die, you can put my body in a box, but my soul belongs to God and has a reservation. Oh, God, I wish I had a church. I wish I had somebody in a row that believes that I'm on my way to heaven and you can't take me off my square. The just shall live by faith. It means the just. I have the same problems that other folk have on the job. I have the same problems in the neighborhood that other folks are dealing with. They're being with their cars being broken into. They're being in a place with things happening that just shouldn't be happening. I'm dealing with the same injustice, but the difference between me and them, my friend, is that I've been justified. Lord have mercy. I've been set apart. God, and one of these days I won't have these problems. Oh Lord, have mercy. One of these days I'm going to throw in my mortgage, throw in my hair, throw in my car payment, and tell the devil that's the last payment I made. I'm on my way to my final destination. The just live by faith. Amen.
Glory to God.
The just.
That's good.
I may have the same problems, but don't let your problems define you. Don't let your problems define you. I've learned that as long as you're in this life, you're going to have problems. As long as you're in this life, there will be struggles. But the just, those who can justify, I'm looking to overcome problems and I'm afraid. I got 6 minutes and I got 3 points. I got the close. I got 3 minutes. I got 2 minutes to point. Lord have mercy. The book of Romans is a doctrinal book, which means it deals with your belief that should drive your behavior. So what Paul is writing in this text, he is saying very clearly, amen, praise God, that the just shall live by faith. He is declaring that faith is a critical ingredient. Amen, praise God. So therefore, if faith is critical to the justification of the believer, it makes unbelief the greatest sin.
Say so.
Let me say that again. It makes unbelief the greatest sin. Because you can't get to heaven without faith. Help me out for a second. You can't get to heaven without faith. So anything that is opposite to faith is against what God's plan is for my life. And the greatest enemy to the cross is my doubt. I wish I had somebody like that. Then the Bible declares, amen, praise God. It's so important is this text that, amen, praise God, in Hebrews 2 and 4, Romans 1 and 7, amen, praise God, Hebrews, amen, praise God, 5, I think in 38, it says it this way, all of them says one thing, the just
shall live
by faith. It's almost as though when God echoes himself, repeats himself, he's trying to give a message for the church that they would believe. It's not your shout that's going to get you in. It's not your pants that's going to get you in. It's your faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ that's going to justify you. So while folk may condemn you, folk may talk about you, it won't matter because your faith is what justifies you. I wish I had a church in here. Now faith is the most important ingredient to our belief in God because it settles the sin problem. But not only does it settle the sin problem, it settles even the living problem. What do you mean the living problem? Well, amen, first I want three, here's the 3 points with 5 minutes. All the promises of God are received. let me say it one more time. I don't know who I'm working with, but if you can put it up on the screen. All the promises of God are received by faith. Now, let me if you go preach your name, because we only got about 7 minutes left. Touch your name as a neighbor. All the promises of God are received by faith. So I don't know what God promised you. I don't know what he's be fulfilled in your life. You don't have to learn to reach up by faith and grab it. You don't have to reach up and pull it down. You don't have to take it from the realm of the unseen into the realm of the seen. Now, you don't have to take it from the impossible into the realm of the possible. Jesus said, Jesus, I want to receive the promise. But in order to receive the promise, you're going to have to speak to me. You're going to have to tell me something. You're going to have to speak to my situation. My situation is a storm out on the water. My situation is a boat is rocking. My situation is that I got 11 out of 4 who don't believe me in this situation. But you have to speak to me, Lord. If that is you, give me the call. Touch your name and say, Lord, touch your name. Peter, come. Oh God, that's all he made was one promise. Peter, if you step out, I'll handle the rest. I don't know who God is talking to, but if you step out, I'll handle the rest. If you step out, you set yourself apart from the situation. If you come out, the promise is long enough. If you get one foot out from the promise, I'll handle the rest. I'll take care of your stuff.
She is the widow of Zarephath, and God